sponsored by the Georgetown University Alumni Association and Alumni Career Services. Thank you for taking the time to join us today. My name is Sarah Hay, Assistant Director of Alumni Career Services, and our presenter today is Brooke Holtom, a professor in the McDonough School of Business. Today's webinar has been very well received by our alumni community. We had over 500 alumni register, and right now there are over 100 of you on the line. That number is growing, so we're so happy that everyone took an interest in this topic. And before we begin, I'd just like to share a few housekeeping tips and reminders. Today's presentation is being recorded. You can access the replay of this webinar within 3 business days on our YouTube channel. To access, simply go to youtube.com on the channel side and search Georgetown Alumni Career Services. You can also look in your chat box. I sent everyone the link directly if you just want to click on that right now. There are 2 audio options. You can listen via your computer speakers or dial into the conference bridge number provided. You are not required to have a headset, but are welcome to use one. It is important to note if you experience audio difficulties while listening through your computer speakers, this can be caused by having multiple software applications open. So feel free to close some of these applications or simply join us via the conference bridge number provided in your reminder email. Questions are welcome. Please type in your questions in the question area on your GoToWebinar control panel screen. Brooks is planning to answer as many questions as time will allow during the Q&A portion at the end of the presentation. And following this, I will email everyone a copy of his slide, so don't feel like you have to write everything down. If you're having any technical difficulties, please submit those concerns to me via the chat area if possible. And without further ado, I'd like to tell you a bit more about our presenter. As I said, Brooks Holtom is a professor in the McDonough School of Business and has been recognized by former students with Professor of the Year awards and by fellow academics with numerous Best Paper awards. He has more than 20 years of experience teaching negotiations and has worked with executives from a wide range of organizations, including Bayer, Booz Allen Hamilton, Nordstrom, the International Monetary Fund, and the World Bank. His research focuses on how organizations acquire, develop, and retain human and social capital. So Brooks, we are thrilled to have you here today. I will tell everyone right now, as Brooks has told me, this webinar is focusing mainly on those who are switching careers and want help on initiating that first salary negotiation when you're about to start a job. So if you're inside an organization and looking to be promoted, we won't be touching as much on the subject of negotiating that raise. But you are welcome to stay on the line today and then also listen in on a September webinar we're doing on salaries and bonuses, and that will focus more on that internal promotion. So we just wanted to give that disclaimer. And before I turn it over to Brooks, I am going to ask you all a few questions. We're just curious who we have on the line today, what our audience looks like. So if you could tell me, how many years has it been since your Georgetown graduation? Just go ahead and take this quick poll. Okay, and I'll just give everyone a couple seconds to vote. All right, I'm going to go ahead and close that out. So we have 47% of people on the line who are in the first 5 years of their career, so that's very interesting. 30% of people on the line are in 6 to 15 years since graduation. 11% are in the 16 to 25 years since graduation range. 10% graduated 25 to 35 years ago, and 2% of people graduated over 35 years ago. So it's great to see a range of you on the line. Very interesting that most of you are in the beginning of your career. And next question, what school at Georgetown did you graduate from? And I apologize that we were not able to list all of them. GoToWebinar limited me, but this will at least give us some idea. All right, I'm going to close that out. Don't answer quickly. Okay, so 19% of folks on the line graduated from the college, 21% from SFS, undergrad or graduate, 30% from MSB, undergrad or graduate, 3% from NHS, and 27% from other schools. So last question, do you plan to engage in a salary negotiation in the next 1 to 2 years? Yes, no, or you're still thinking about it. And maybe you'll change your mind after today's presentation. Okay, I'm going to go ahead and close that out. All right, so as we probably guessed, Brooks, 80% of people on the line do plan to engage in a salary negotiation in the next 1 to 2 years. 6% do not, and 14% are still contemplating. But hopefully we'll leave this webinar feeling empowered. So Brooks, finally, I will turn it over to you. Thank you for joining us today. It's great to have you here.
Thank you. It's a pleasure. I am thrilled to have so many people joining us for the webinar. I hope sincerely that it'll be worth the time that you invest, in particular those on the other side of the country. I've received emails from students in Singapore and other places. You're giving up valuable sleep, so I hope that you find this both enjoyable and productive. Let me acknowledge right up front that with so many participants with such varied experience, there will undoubtedly be people who are extremely well-practiced and experienced in these types of negotiations. Most people will be somewhere kind of in the middle with a moderate level of experience, and there'll be some people with very little experience. My goal is to speak to the vast majority of you, and if you're at the far right-hand tail of the distribution and find that there are questions you have that aren't answered in the course of the discussion, please do email those questions in or submit those questions so that I can answer them at the end. But I want to start by asking you a couple of questions. One is, whether you write this down or in your head and you count on your fingers, can you give me 10 synonyms for negotiate or negotiation? I'll let you think. If your list is anything like some of the lists I see when I'm working with executive MBAs, you get something here like a fight or a battle. Talk about contracts. People will say things like deal or haggle or conversation or a bargain, or we're looking for win-win, or maybe this is about arguing or agreeing, or we're looking to go to mediation or arbitration or finding a way to resolve our conflict. Let me transition directly to the question of where do you negotiate? Do you negotiate at work? Do you negotiate at home? Do you negotiate major purchases? Where is it that you're negotiating? Some of you negotiated this morning with your alarm clock. Some of you went to a buffet where they had a large dessert table, and you negotiated with yourself over whether or not to have an extra cookie and also whether or not you're going to go to the gym after work. Anyway, we're constantly negotiating, whether those are internal issues or external issues, whether they're at work or they're at home with a significant other or with children. We're negotiating, and that's really the point of this introductory couple of slides, is to say, what is it that we're negotiating? And one of the most prominent of those at work is salary. It's clearly important to most people, but there are other things that are important, like budgets for your department for the coming year, deadlines when you must provide certain deliverables, and the shape of those deliverables, the content of those deliverables, and responsibilities around those deliverables. At home, I know there would be fantastic responses from this audience. Some of the things that are negotiated are chores, finances, for example, where the income will derive from, but also where we'll spend it. If you have children like I do, I have four ranging from 7 to 16, there are negotiations, especially during the summer, over bedtime, what television shows might watch or movies, or things like video games. In short, your family may be like this family. It's a modern family with a lot of chaotic and unusual things happening, and you're constantly negotiating. Now, my next question is, for those of you who are married or in a relationship, who's winning? Now, I can see a couple of you raising your hands and saying, I'm winning. I can see another couple saying, no, I'm definitely not winning. She's winning or he's winning. And let me just pause here and say, that is an absolutely terrible question to ask. But people do this all the time. They keep score. They want to know who's winning. But I would submit, in the context of families and relationships with significant others, that's the wrong question to be asking. And I'll come back to that in just a minute. So what we know is that most people are negotiating every day with themselves, with coworkers, with family members, and sometimes negotiating access to lanes on the freeways and parking spots. There are a variety of places, verbal and nonverbal places we're negotiating. And we learn it from very early age here. The mom says, hey, we're leaving in 5 minutes. The son counters, no, 10. And then she meets somewhere in the middle and saying 7, then it's time to go. But we learned this early on by experience. It's shaped extensively by the norms of families as well as culture, the country that we live in. There are norms that govern negotiation processes. So the question I ask now is, do you want to succeed more often in negotiation? My assumption, that because you're on this webinar, is yes. And I'm going to reveal now the answer to how to succeed. It's P3. If there's anything to write down today, this is it, P3. What does P3 mean? Well, if you want to succeed in negotiations more frequently, more often, with better results, you need to first prepare, second prepare, and third prepare. If you want to succeed in negotiations, you have to be willing to pay the price. Sometimes our conceptions of what success in negotiation looks like is framed by movies. They're, you know, desperate, risk-filled situations where there's a hostage that's been taken and directives are given and you do this or else. Well, these types of high-risk negotiations are highly unusual. They're not our prototype. And in specific, as we look to salary negotiations, there's much that an individual can do in advance to increase the odds of success. And I think this is a good place to pause and say, look, when you see an airport book that says, I guarantee you, you can win X, Y, or Z, get 50% more salary, etc., these guarantees are a little bit flimsy. I don't believe that there's any one given tactic that is guaranteed to work in all situations, because in fact, you will be negotiating with different individuals constantly over the course of your life, and they will have different personality predispositions. They will have different authorization levels. They will have different sympathies towards you and or your arguments. You may know them well. You may not know them at all. And so all of these factors will shape the probability of success. So when I say prepare, 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 what I really mean is you want to do everything within your control to increase the odds of success. And over the long term, over the course of your career, you will succeed more often than not. You will succeed more often than others, and you ultimately will be benefited throughout the course of a career. So this is my starting place, and actually you'll see it's also the ending place for this webinar, is prepare, prepare, prepare. And now I'll get into specifics. Prepare in terms of what? Now, what's special about salary negotiations is that many people become uncomfortable. in asking for salary. They feel some that it's beneath them. Others feel that they shouldn't have to ask, that it should be recognized. But it's important that you get what you believe that you're worth, in part because it not only affects your financial situation, but it also feeds into the probability that you'll stay with the organization and that you'll be motivated to perform well, both of which are important incentives for the organization to get this right also. And so it's natural for us to think about what we want and what's important to us, and also to get a bit anxious before having these conversations. But you should know on the other side is someone who's preparing to come and negotiate, and they're typically equally anxious to make sure that this negotiation goes well. They probably don't know you well, and they're still trying to assess your capabilities and qualifications. One of the questions I'll often get from MBA students or undergraduate students is, well, professor, if I negotiate my salary, and in particular, if I make strong demands or if I am assertive in this process, do you think it will hurt me coming into the organization? And the response I would give to that question is, well, it depends, and it depends on the organization and what they do. And it also depends on how you ask. So let me first talk to what the organization does. I worked previously for a large consulting firm, and one of the important competencies that we looked for in new hires was the ability to negotiate, because you're constantly negotiating with clients, whether it's the overall bill or the specific deliverables within a project, timelines, or other aspects. It was important for us to hire consultants who are skilled negotiators, and so to the extent that you're both tactful but also effective as a negotiator in the salary negotiation process, the organization is better off. There may be some instances where that's less true, but in general, if you have the right approach, meaning you're respectful, well-prepared, thoughtful, and not issuing ultimatums in the course of your salary negotiations, it's likely that you'll impress the employer and less likely that you'll offend them. So I appreciate that you don't want to offend or scare off a future employer, and that's why in part we'll talk about timing as we progress here. Now, we could also say this is potentially more touchy at this particular junction in our economic history, where we're coming out slowly of a recession and jobs are still relatively tight. So some people will be tempted to take simply what's offered and not be greedy, quote unquote. But I'd say that you should not. You should in fact think about what's important to you in this job and negotiate to the very best of your ability to try to secure what's important. And we'll talk now about these proven strategies to negotiate a better offer. Now, the fundamental mindset has got to be win-win. I choose dice here because they capture nicely the win-win concept, but it's not that this is a roll of the dice. You can do things to systematically increase those odds. And the first is to recognize and internalize the fact that the organization wants to hire an excellent employee to do an important job. And when you get to the point of negotiating salary, which is typically after you have received the offer, they have committed to you as a candidate, and then kicks in what's known as the escalation of commitment bias. Once they have made the offer, it then becomes their goal or their task to get your acceptance. And so they, in fact, psychologically want to find a way to accomplish that. This is especially true of recruiters. So when you're working with a large organization, and this is what someone does professionally, they are rewarded, in fact, for their effectiveness in developing candidates, getting offers for these candidates, and then securing their commitment to work for the firm. It's called the yield rate. And they are measured against their peers based on things like their yield rate. And so they have an incentive to get you to closure, to sign with this organization. In short, they need you. And don't underestimate the fact, once they've made this offer to you, that they have committed to you. It depends on your jurisdiction, and because I know we have people from a variety of countries, I won't speak to specific country-by-country laws, but in most of the countries where you're coming from, once you have a written offer to the degree that you do not cross out or change any terms on that written offer, it's good until it expires, and that assumes now that they've written in this offer expires in 30 days from delivery or 30 days from issuance or some kind of term. And so don't worry, in most cases, by negotiating over the phone, you are not rescinding that contract. Next point. You want to join an excellent organization and do important work, and you need them. But my point in identifying this is you've really got to understand that this is a two-way street, and we're talking about a long-term relationship here. And so don't assume that you're one down. Assume that you're partners in this negotiation, in this enterprise. I do now want to introduce what's known as the dual concerns model. Some of you may have seen this previously, but if not, I'll describe it in some detail because it follows up on what I've just been trying to explain. When we come to a negotiation, there are two primary dimensions that we should think about in advance of negotiating so that we can choose an appropriate strategy. The first is the concern we have for ourselves. And in the case of a salary negotiation, it's very likely to be high because this is important to us. It's one of the primary reasons why we work. If we look at the other dimension across the bottom, the concern that we have for the other party, because you, again, are starting a relationship with an organization, the assumption is that you will also have a high concern for the other party. That automatically puts us now in the red quadrant, or the integrative or collaborative quadrant. That means that the type of tactics that we use in that quadrant include efforts to build trust, to share honest and accurate information, and to look for ways of creating joint value. Now, most people think about negotiations, and when they do, they think about used car purchases or buying a home, these major purchases, and they are typically conducted in the distributive quadrant with a competitive strategy where the goal is to win all you can with relatively little concern for the other party. If you think about buying a home, it's one of the largest, if not the largest purchase a person will ever make. They're only going to do it a few times in their lives. They're unlikely to see the seller again, and so their concern for that party is low. Similarly, in buying a used car, the assumption is, hey, the used car salesman is going to take advantage of me or do the best he can to protect his interests. He has information that I don't have. So I need to be extremely distributive or competitive in my approach to protect myself. If you bring that mindset to a salary negotiation, you put yourself at risk. The assumption in the integrative quadrant is that we both need to be satisfied with this negotiation to have a successful long-term relationship. And so we've got to look beyond just a competitive strategy. Now people will then say, well, but professor, we're talking about my salary. We're talking about money that I'll be able to pay my bills, my loans, provide for my family. That's really important to me. And I'll counter with, yes, of course it is. But it's also important to the company who seeks to be competitive in the marketplace. And if they overpay all of their employees, they can't be competitive from a financial perspective. So they've got to find a balance there between rewarding people well, but also being competitive in the market. Okay, well, if I negotiate for $5,000 more, that means that the company has $5,000 less in profits. Yes, that's true. So doesn't that suggest I win and they lose? And I would respond by saying, yes, but only if that's the only thing that you're negotiating over. And frankly, if you come to a salary negotiate, a job negotiation, and the only thing you're talking about is a salary, you're missing a whole lot of the equation. We'll talk about this later in the webinar, but there are so many important things to negotiate, including job title, job range or scale or grade, depending on the language where you work. We can also talk about things about office space and vacations and training budgets, etc. If the only thing you're negotiating over is the number on your salary, now not talking about bonus or eligibility for bonus or how soon you might have a performance review that would then feed into a possible raise calculation, all of those things, if the only thing you're talking about is money, you definitely need to listen to the next 20 minutes of this webinar, because you cannot come to the negotiation only thinking about money. If you do, the very best you can hope for is to land in that yellow quadrant, which is compromise. It'll be better than not negotiating, but not as good as negotiating all of the elements of a job package. All right, so let's get specific on salary and job negotiations. First is to know your alternatives. The ideal scenario is to have an offer from your second best choice before negotiating with the first best choice, right? So with your preferred employer. So if you're going to work for consulting firms and you want to have leverage with consulting firm A, hopefully you have been extremely busy soliciting interviews, engaging in interviews, and ultimately securing two offers. Now, the timing of the negotiations is important in the sense that you want to negotiate with your second best choice first, because then you will know the value of that alternative. You will know how much salary they're offering, how much vacation they're offering, your start date, etc. And once you know those alternatives, that is your BATNA, your best alternative to a negotiated agreement. And that gives you leverage as you go to work with your best employer or first choice. Now, in a challenging economy, I recognize that you may be less likely to have alternatives or other offers. Therefore, you must be creative. I highlight this in red. There are ways to work with this. First is to understand and then be able to explain the value you bring to the organization, which is not only skills and knowledge and abilities and experience, but also your social network. It's the people you know, the quality of those relationships, and other factors that bring value to the organization. It's not enough to have that. You've got to be able to clearly articulate that. Next, you want to be able to demonstrate that you have exactly the right skills and experience. That's why you're going to do your homework up front to really truly understand what they need in terms of this position. Then look at your experience, education, and other factors that allow you to argue persuasively that you are the very best person for this job on the planet. Not that you're good enough or that you can just get over the bar, but why you are the absolute best person on the planet for this job. Will that take time? Yes. I would say it differently. That takes preparation to really truly understand what they need and how you can deliver that. I would encourage you strongly to document your excellence, whether that's achievements or awards. I would call that a brag file. It's probably electronic. It's on your computer. Whenever you get an email of praise from a customer, from a boss, from a colleague, you just PDF it and put it in that brag file so that you can take that with you. You want to make sure that you have these documented excellence, because it will help you make the case in a challenging economy that you are awesome. And this is where I want to share a favorite photo I found reveal your inner Superman, all right? You have got to, in a tactful way, demonstrate that you can do amazing things on behalf of this employer. And that's why they should pay you and compensate you the way that you're negotiating. All right. So do your research. Information is absolutely power. I can guarantee you from consulting with more than 100 of the Fortune 500 at this point that the organizations do their homework. They participate in salary surveys. Yes, with peers. When I went into the financial accounting universe upon graduating with my master's degree in accounting, I was so shocked to find that all of the offers within a region, I was going to Seattle, were within $500 of the other firms. There were six firms, major firms at the time, had offers from four of them, and those offers were all within $500 of each other. Why? Because they participate in salary surveys. They're anonymous, but consultants will feedback exactly what the peers are paying, not with the names, but with the percentiles, etc. So they know. They know the market rate for most of their positions, and they seek out information about their competitors regularly, including from you. After you sign on the dotted line, they are absolutely, if they haven't already, going to ask you, what were the other offers that you had? How much were they offering in terms of relocation? Because they want to update their models continually so that they can be competitive. In other words, organizations are doing their homework. Therefore, you have to do your homework. And so let me talk about that. What should the position pay? You can go to places like salary.com, payscale.com, vault.com. You can, and there are many others. You can talk to trusted colleagues who are at the organization. How do you find them? Well, through your contacts on LinkedIn. Let's say you're going to an investment bank. Who do you know at that firm? You may not know someone directly, but you have a second level contact who can introduce you. There's an intermediary who can help you get access to someone at the organization, and you can ask them those questions. You can go to a career advisor or a coach, and many times career centers can provide this information. Now, if you find it a little bit difficult to ask a friend sensitive, try indirect inquiry. In other words, ask them, I'm looking at this particular organization and this particular position. What do you think the organization would pay for this position? That's very different from asking, hey, what do you make, right? And you could say, well, great, and you probably know the other organizations in this industry, and based on your experience, what do you think other organizations would pay for this position? And you can get multiple data points from the same person, but also seek out other people so that you can get multiple data points to triangulate towards a good understanding of what the position should pay. What does this sound like? It sounds like work. But again, that's part of prepare, prepare, prepare. All right. Now, I would use this market data to set expectations. What does that mean? First, your own. This is your kind of come to grips with reality portion of the exercise. You may have hoped for a job that paid X, but if you do your homework, and specifically in a different geography, right, if you were researching jobs in New York and ultimately for personal reasons you decide you want to go to St. Louis or Kansas City, you should not expect the same pay in the central part of the U.S. as you would on the coast for the same job. And so you want to make sure you're calibrated and don't have unrealistic expectations. But beyond your own expectations, the hiring manager may or may not be perfectly calibrated, and so market data will want to you'll want to use to set expectations. A good recruiter is going to ask you about salary requirements, and that often makes people nervous. First word of advice there is to be honest. Because you've done your homework, you should have a good idea in mind. It saves both sides time and trouble. if there's no way they're close to being able to pay what you believe you're worth in this particular job, there's no reason to engage in a protracted negotiation, so it'll save you time, trouble, and heartache. Also, if you're a top candidate, most employers will work to what they'll do what they can to make the numbers work, all right, to work with you. I would always, though, be sure to respond in terms of the market. And I would say something like, from my research, I understand that the average for this position is, and then I would cite the number. Now, it may be that you want to cite the median, which could be higher, or the 75th percentile. I can tell you, having worked at three different universities, that different universities will try to pay at different percentiles for their professors. So hypothetically here, if you're working for a business school that's ranked 75th in the country, they would likely have a policy of paying at the 50th percentile. But if you move up to a school that's in the top 25, it's much more likely that they're paying at, say, the 75th or the 80th percentile. And you can find that data for university professors at the different percentile levels. Similarly, you can do that in most positions. And so coming in, you can say, I assume because you are the top-ranked consulting firm in your industry that you would not pay at the 50th percentile or average, but are likely to be at the 75th. And on the basis of my research, the 75th percentile for this position pays X. Again, it's couched in terms of the market. You absolutely want to make sure that you are adjusting for the cost of living in this region. So you can say, I assume that the 75th percentile is X, and based on the national average, there should be a small adjustment for the cost of living in the Washington, D.C., or the Los Angeles, or the New York region. That's less likely to be the case if you're in Alabama or Nebraska. So this is not pejorative against, those are great places to live, but the cost of living is not as high. So you need to be prepared to adjust modestly from that, and there are great calculators to help you do that. Hiring managers do not care how old your car is and how much you'd like to have a new one. Hiring managers are really not keen to hear your arguments about why you want a two-bedroom place rather than a one-bedroom place. All of these are in the background for you or are important, but not relevant to this conversation. Let me repeat, not relevant, too much information, not helpful. Okay, so my point here is to keep it focused on the market. That helps to depersonalize it. It helps to make this an easier conversation. It's not me versus you. This is the market, and firms that want to hire top talent want to meet the market because they know that good talent in the market takes money and other factors. Now, if you're asked to provide a range, and if you Google range, this is what you're going to get. It was funny. I was trying to look for clever clip art to put into this presentation to keep people awake. And if you put in range and image, this is what comes up. But beyond the Range Rover, if you're asked to provide a range, make sure when you provide that range that you're acceptable with the low end. Because when people on the other end hear this, a hiring manager, if you say, I am comfortable with a range of 100 to 120, the number I guarantee you that they hear is 100. Okay? People hear ranges in terms of what's best for them. And so make sure that you've thought in advance if you're asked for a range, about a range that would be completely acceptable for you at the, both the low and the high end. A second point when asked to provide a range is to consider couching it in terms of the value of the overall package, meaning the health benefits, the retirement benefits, and the other perks that are associated with the job. Benefits for professionals at approximately 50% on average compensation, so going back to the example of making $100,000, the company is likely paying up on average an additional $50,000 in terms of their pay payments that they make to the government for Social Security and Medicare, in terms of paid vacation, retirement, and especially today, health care, which is the largest of these expenses. It's not unusual for it to be, again, 50% of your base. And so if you're currently making 75, but 50% of that's 37.5, and you add all of that up, that's 112.5 is the total package. And so that's another way of talking about a range. And be sure to capture any benefits you'd give up by moving or changing organizations, like unvested stock options. It helps them get a sense of what you're giving up to come to work for them. Now, if their offer is too low, I would respectfully redirect the conversation. Again, it's not personal. Don't make it personal. Don't say, oh, I'm offended, but say something like, maybe I've not adequately conveyed the value I think I bring to the table, because that sounds like an offer for someone who is perhaps more junior than I am, who is perhaps doing a different type of job, who has less experience. And then I'd go back to the market. On the basis of my research, someone with this skill set, experience range, in this position, on average, or at the 75th percentile, is likely being paid X. Okay? So again, it's not personal. It's talking about the offer and the market. Now, consider more than just salary. Think about other important aspects, including starting grade or level, the chance to work with senior executives, opportunities for advancement, exciting assignments, the location where you'll work, telecommuting options, flexible hours, training budgets, or vacation. In most organizations, I'm not guaranteeing you that every company will negotiate on every one of these terms. And this is probably an important point for me to say, your very first job, right out of school, organizations largely look at you as undifferentiated goods, like a commodity such as beans or rice or oil. So they make standard offers. But after that first job, most of you become differentiated goods with differentiated talents, abilities, experiences, and therefore they expect to negotiate on many, if not all, of these possible dimensions, because these are important and are likely to become more important to you over the course of your career. Things like flexible hours, working 4 days, 10 hours a week, and having Fridays off, for example, or other arrangements that allow you to balance work and family life. These have huge value, and I'll talk in a minute about being able to quantify the value of those to you. So, in the discussion, the language I hope you'll use is to focus on we. Anticipate the boss's interests and demands. Make sure that you're aware of how you're coming off to the hiring manager or the recruiter. I would not give a list of demands, but I would show that you're trying to come up with solutions that meet the needs of the employer as well as your own. Use positive language, recognize when they make concessions, express appreciation for those, again, seeking for the win-win solution, and demonstrate you're open to proposals other than your own by listening carefully, asking follow-up questions. Now, I want to share with you a creative idea. A student came to me. This was an undergraduate student who was going to work for a manufacturing firm. It was a relatively small firm, and she said, Professor, I've received an offer, and the offer is for $50,000 starting salary with a $10,000 sign-on slash moving allowance. Now, I clarified to her that for most entry-level jobs, the expected tenure is around 2 years. So when you think about this, if you spread the bonus over 2 years, that means no extra cost to the firm on average. So the lifetime of value to the individual is much larger. Why? Because a future raise is being based on past salary, and because it sets a benchmark for future salary negotiations. Now let me recap this so that the example is clear. We're talking about a new college graduate going to work for a firm that's relatively small. Her initial offer was for $50,000 with a $10,000 sign-on / moving bonus. I recommended to her, ask them if they would, instead of giving the $10,000 sign-on bonus, make your initial salary $55,000 with no sign-on bonus. And she looked at me with big eyes like, whoa, settle down. It feels like you're giving away $5,000 of my money. I said, well, how long do you expect to be with this firm? She said, this is my dream company. This is what I want to do. I expect to be there for my career, but at very least, I'm there for 2 to 5 years. I said, okay. Now, if this $5,000 increase in salary the first year then becomes part of your base, your salary next year, let's say you get a 4% raise, so you're going to increase this now by another $2,000, your base next year is $57,000. Now, what has happened? That $10,000 sign-on bonus has helped you to start with a base that will continue throughout your career. How many years are you going to work? Well, probably 40 years. And how many years will you enjoy that $5,000? 40 times the $5,000 plus, because the base typically raises are a percentage on the base, it becomes built in. So now the future value of this is hundreds of thousands of dollars. And I said, not only that, the present value of this annuity is $85,000 in today's value. This one idea is worth $85,000 for you today. That's the present value of this annuity. You can see my assumption is 5% over 40 years in terms of the rate. And if it's 4%, you can see what it is with this graph. If it's 6%, you can see what it is with this graph. What is my point? My point is that future raises will be based on your starting salary. And that's especially true when you move from firm A to firm B 5 years down the road. Many times they'll ask, what were you being paid before? And if you were able to bump up that salary before, you're better off for the rest of your career. All right? So that's what I mean by be creative. Think out of the box. Find ways that it has no cost to the employer in current terms based on their assumptions, but for you has long-term value. All right. I know the time is drawing quickly to a close. I have just a couple more slides. First, you need to understand the relative value of different aspects of a job to you and capture that in a spreadsheet so you can make trade-offs. What are flexible hours worth to you? Are they worth $10,000 a year or five? What is telecommuting worth to you? Your ability to work from home 3 days a week in terms of less wear and tear on the car, tolls, parking fees, gas, but also stress and the additional time that you save for your hobbies, for exercise, or other things. All right, the ability to work from the beach. What's landing in your preferred location worth to you? Not only in cost savings from lower rent, but also being close to family or friends. What's a permanent full-time employment contract worth to you compared to part-time or contract employment? And can the company pay you more if you don't use the health benefits? For example, if you have them through a spouse, some organizations today will allow you to opt out of their health care benefits. And because of that, they might be willing to give you those benefits in terms of health club memberships or other benefits. All right, so these are creative ideas for finding more value in the negotiation process. So some helpful hints, be honest, not only because it's the right thing to do, but because it sets the tone as you enter the organization. This is a long-term relationship. Information flows very fast today. And so whether it's Twitter or Facebook or other media, Information flows quickly, and so if something out there in the marketplace is dishonest, it'll be corrected quickly. Stay away from I statements, always work from we. Remember, this isn't personal, but it may feel that way. But in 99% of the cases, this is simply business, and you can't make it personal. Wait until you have an offer to negotiate. You may want to try to negotiate performance pay. If I hit the following benchmarks, would I be eligible for a one-time bonus or an increase? We've talked about that. Definitely your advantage to role play this with a friend or a colleague in advance. Think of the hardest questions that your potential employer could ask you, and then come back and have that friend or colleague ask you. Now, if it's not base pay, it might be title, tuition, wardrobe allowance, commute assistance, housing assistance, daycare assistance, additional vacation days, an office with a window. You need to be creative and think of in advance, what if they can't make movement on salary? What else is important to me? And finally, my parting advice, prepare, prepare, prepare. That's a good point for us to pause and for me to now take questions. Thanks so much for listening.
Absolutely, Brooke. Thank you so much for all that very helpful information. I welcome everyone to type in any questions you have at this time, but I'll start it off with this. When do you advise someone to just take the offer that's on the table to avoid any backfire with further negotiations? I know you've already covered this a bit, but if someone received one offer from a company with about the same total compensation package that's about 30% higher than their current job, well, you know what, I won't get into the details since I know we don't have a lot of time. But in general, can you just give any more advice on when you think people should pull out
and sure.
take the offer on the table?
First, let me reiterate that it's important to wait until you have the formal offer to negotiate. Once you have the offer, then I would typically ask an introductory question, which is to say, in many organizations, it's customary to negotiate offers after they're given. May I assume that that's also true here? Because that's a soft way to say, I'd like to negotiate the terms of this particular agreement. If the response is absolutely not, we view that as a violation of trust or a violation of the spirit of this contract, if this is your preferred firm, then I would be prepared to stand down. But that has not been my experience. And as a researcher, that's not what the research says either. Most organizations anticipate that you'll negotiate. And that's why asking a soft introductory question, their response being yes, opens the door or allows you tactfully to go about that process. Only in the case where they say absolutely not, we view that as a cultural affront or somehow that's inappropriate, would you come back and say, okay, then I'll stand down. Thanks for that question.
And when employers ask you up front, before you've gone in for an interview, what your salary expectations are, how should you respond?
Again, I would go directly to the market data, and I would have in advance anticipated what this position should pay. I will have done my homework so that there are regional adjustments, and I would provide them with a number that you believe represents the fair market value for that job. Now, you probably want to be a little bit optimistic, and I would say in the range of 5 to 10% optimistic is within what's kind of a reasonable range. So if the position you believe should pay 100 in that particular location, starting at 110 allows you to negotiate and not hurt yourself down towards that 100 number. But if you asked for 150, that typically would be viewed as unreasonable and not a fair starting place for the negotiation. So 5 to 10% above what you believe is fair market rate is typically what we would see or recommend based on research. Thank you.
And as an employer, should I offer the maximum amount that I can with the idea of making the offer seem more attractive to applicants, or should I offer less than the maximum in case the candidate is going to come back and negotiate?
That's a super question. So I appreciate having the employer perspective represented in the webinar. In general, I would, as a recruiter or a hiring manager, anticipate that people will negotiate. And so I would not typically put out my very top number to start. And I can give you a very clear example of this. One of my former students was a recruiter for Microsoft, and he was recruiting for a very technical position, and the talent for this position was very thin. They were doing a worldwide search, and he had been authorized to pay $400,000 in base salary for this individual. But when he started this negotiation after giving the offer to the technician, he said, and what would you expect to be paid for your services? And the candidate said $200,000. My student immediately came back and said, that is outstanding. We would be very pleased to pay you $200,000, and I'm prepared in addition to give you stock options for this position, as well as a number of other benefits, including vacation, et cetera, et cetera. What if my student had started at $400,000? He would have given away $200,000 of value there. All right, so I think that that's part of why good hiring managers will often ask that question in advance, so that they can see how well calibrated to the market the candidate is. Thanks for that question.
Okay, great, and we have a lot of questions here. People are really worried about what they should put when employers ask for your salary history. How do you think this can either help or hurt that situation?
Sure, so this is not uncommon. It's important to clarify whether they're asking for base salary or total compensation. And this is where, again, I would, if I were asked to provide that, I would talk in terms of total compensation, but I would make it clear that I was talking in terms of total compensation. So the value of my salary, my vacation, my retirement pay, my health care benefits. And so if hypothetically my base was 100 and they asked me for my salary requirements, I would say the total package I would expect would be $150,000, if that's, you know, what I expected, because that's the total value of my package. But I would make it clear that was not my base, but in fact my overall package. Now, if you're changing industries and you're going, say, from the not-for-profit world, where you are making $60,000 a year, but you have a great work ethic and experience base, and you're now changing from not-for-profit to the for-profit world, you should have done your homework in advance to know that a similar position in the for-profit world might be paying $80,000. And so in that context, I would be very clear that I did not believe that was the relevant market. And so I would not answer that question directly saying I was paid X in the not-for-profit world, but instead my understanding of the market in the for-profit world for this particular position with this skill set is paying X.
That is a great point. And could you provide, again, some great websites? I know you mentioned some before where people can go to research what the salaries are in various industries, and especially if you have any advice on where people can do research on the jobs that are a little bit more unique and their salaries for those positions might not be as well advertised as other ones.
Sure. So I recognize the limitations of many of the websites that you'll find online. If you put a search term like salary survey or pay across the U.S. or regional cost of living adjustments, you can do that quite easily. I know that you'll do that well. One of the most creative responses to this was I had a couple of MBAs who came to me and they said, Professor, we're not going into investment banking. We're not going into consulting. We don't have a good idea what these jobs should be paying. But look, there are five of us who are going into this industry this year, and we really want to do a good job in preparing ourselves for the salary negotiations, what's your suggestion? And I would say I would look to a salary consultant in that specific industry and see if the five of you couldn't go in and share the expense of that report. Well, it turns out that a report for that specific type of job cost $5,000 from the world's best salary consultant. They split that five ways, so they each paid $1,000, but because of the differentiated information they had, they each earned more than $10,000 more than what they were getting from the different salary surveys that were more generic or not relevant to them. So here, sometimes there's an investment required to get good data, but then you can share that data with the employer. And three of those five students did share that data directly with the employer. And especially when it's not a big, you know, multinational company that's used to doing these salary surveys all the time, you may be providing data to them that they didn't have to help them get calibrated so that they can pay market rate and attract good talent. And because these students offered that information in a tactful way, saying, we wanted to know what these jobs were worth, and so we invested in this, we're willing to share this data with you. They didn't use it as a lever or a bludgeon, but instead a collaborative tool. They did better in their salary negotiations. So you invest $1,000 to make $10,000, but it's not $10,000 today. That's $10,000 every year for the rest of your career. So that's one creative idea.
All right, well, Brooks, thank you so much. We still do have questions, but I know we're at time, so people may be reaching out to you later. I do encourage everyone to join our webinar on September 24th, The Real Deal with Salaries and Bonuses. We also, for our alumni, do have a webinar that we've done in the past on negotiation strategies for women, so check out our YouTube channel for that. And our next webinar is happening on September 5th. For any entrepreneurs out there, we'll be discussing trademark law basics. For people who are starting their own company. So anyway, Brooks, thank you so much for taking the time to speak with us today. Good luck to everyone who is going to be entering into a negotiation, and we hope to see you all soon on another session.
Thank you.
Bye.